R.G. Lee.
The Bible, the inspired, infallible, inerrant Word of God, teaches us of the fact of a hell of conscious, eternal punishment for the impenitent, for those who reject the Lord Jesus Christ, through whom salvation can be and is secured. Is there heaven? Then there must be a hell. The Bible talks to us about heaven. The Bible talks to us about hell. The same Bible that tells us about the glories and the bliss of heaven tells us about the miseries and the torments of hell. To take the doctrine of hell out of our thinking, out of our teaching, out of our preaching, out of our education, to take away the physician and leave the disease, to take away the lighthouse and leave the hidden rocks on which the ships go down, to take away the vaccine and leave the smallpox, to take away the lamp and leave the darkness. Hell is an awful reality.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Estus Pirkle, and I'm here at Mount Sinai. It was here many, many years ago that Moses climbed this mountain. We could recount the burning bush, God's voice from heaven, the Ten Commandments, but our story today deals with another aspect of this area. But first, let me read my text. In Matthew 10, 28, Jesus said, "And fear not them which kill the body, but after that have nothing more that they can do, but rather fear him who's able to destroy both soul and body in hell fire." What a sobering thought. Jesus was talking about a place called hell, and it was in an expanse like this that we see for the first time people actually being put into hell. In Numbers 16, 16 through 34, we find the first time in the Bible we read and experience about people going to hell. As the people of Israel wandered around in a seemingly endless desert, three of Israel's most powerful leaders, Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, rebelled against God's appointed leaders, Moses and Aaron. Moses told them they were not rebelling against man, but against God. And Moses warned them God would show them who was his.
"Moses, you take too much upon yourself, saying you're holy. What about us? We're just as holy as you are."
"Hereby shall you know that the Lord has sent me to do all these works, for I haven't done them of myself. Now, if these men die the common death of all men, or if these men be visited after the visitation of all men, then the Lord hath not sent me. But if the Lord will make a new thing, and the earth would open up her mouth and swallow them up, and all that appertain unto them, then shall you know that these men have rebelled, and that these men have provoked the Lord."
Ravings of a madman. Such rantings always imply that he's the only one among us that God speaks through. I say, if you're going to do something, do it now.
That shock you? Well, it should, because we're giving you a slight glimpse of an event the Bible tells us about, and the Bible is the Word of God. But perhaps you're saying, preacher, why a picture on hell? Well, in the first place, there are many modernistic preachers who are telling their congregations that hell is simply here on earth when the Bible teaches otherwise. It was some months back when I was preparing a sermon. In fact, my subject was hell. My wife had let two young men in to see me. I had no idea what they wanted, and they had no idea I was a preacher.
Good morning, gentlemen. I'm sorry to have kept you waiting. Please be seated. Gentlemen, I'm certain you had something special on your mind this fine Sunday morning. What is it you want to talk with me about?
Like, man, we come to talk to you about Jesus.
Good. Then you fellas are out witnessing for the Lord.
Witnessing? I ain't having no witnessing.
We don't quite understand.
Soul winning. Trying to bring people to Jesus so that they won't have to go to hell.
Well, that's heavy.
Actually, what we had in mind was a discussion with you about prophecy, about coming events, according to this book.
I see. What book is that?
It's Dr. Long's book. He's an expert, you know.
Listen, if you fellas came to talk about prophecy, why don't you just stick to the Bible?
The Bible's too hard to understand. Dr. Long makes prophecy simple.
Like our church is new, you dig? It's the new thing.
In keeping with the trends of today's world.
I can see that. This Bible talks about a literal hell where sinners burn forever and forever. What do you fellas think about that?
According to Dr. Long, God would never condemn anyone to a burning hell.
Then why did he say that he would in the Bible?
Hey, the Bible don't say no such thing.
It teaches that the wicked go to Hades. Hades is simply a grave.
Is that right? Where'd you get your information?
From the original Greek, and translated to the King James Version, the word hell means grave.
Have either of you read the Greek New Testament?
You gotta be putting me on.
No, we haven't.
Well, I have, and I can assure you that the Greek New Testament teaches a literal burning hell where sinners spend eternity if they're not saved. Gentlemen, I hate to be rude, but I've got a sermon to preach and I've got quite a little preparing to do.
Oh, I'm sorry. We didn't know you were a preacher. If we had, we wouldn't have stopped by.
Amen to that.
Well, that's all right. And a matter of fact, I'm glad you did. I'd like to invite you to come hear me preach.
Hey, preach, what are you preaching on?
My subject is hell.
Ain't we having a good time?
Let me tell you something, young man. Hell is not to be taken lightly. And unless you are saved, that's where you two are headed for right now.
What a rip-off. God should leave me alone. Hey, preach, I want you to dig this. If I do go to hell, there's going to be a lot of my friends waiting there on me. Do you understand?
Yeah.
I said, leave me alone. One more thing, preach. If I ever decide to get saved, you'll be the dude that I call on. But don't hold your breath, because I got me some living to do. You know what I mean?
Wait a minute, Ken. What's the harm of going to his service? I'd kind of like to hear him.
I'd kind of like... Well, you go hear him. You do your thing, I'll do mine. Oh, enjoyed the sermon on hell. I just named Brian to preach.
I'm sorry, Reverend.
Our text for today is Matthew 10:28, where Jesus said, "And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." Jesus declared hell to be an awful place. My desire today in preaching to you on hell is to help you to consider it the same way and to turn from the road to hell to the road to heaven. Jesus did not make hell for humans. He made it for the devil and his angels. Yet the Bible declares there are more people going to hell than there are to heaven. In Matthew 7:13-14, Jesus said, "Enter ye in at the strait gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Because strait is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth to life, and few there be that find it." Statistics prove that 6,000 people die every hour. That means that half that number go to hell. That means that every hour over 3,000 people go to hell. Every minute, over 60 go to hell. At this precise moment, someone is headed for a burning hell. Many people do not plan to go to hell. They intend to get saved by and by. Yet their downfall comes because they are following friends who are leading them straight to hell. What do you think of when the word hell is used? Is it just a byword to fill up conversation? Many people use the words hell and damn so lightly that even when a preacher uses them, some people consider him to be cursing. Yet God did not intend for this to be the case. These words used in the Bible were intended to bring conviction and repentance to the sinner. Hear Mark 16:16. He that believeth not shall be damned. Hear Revelation 20:15. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Do these sound like bywords? Excuse me for a moment, please.
Ken's gone, preacher. We were on a gravel road, and he went over a hill, and he lost control. Preacher, he's dead. I got to know. Is he just going to a grave? He's not going to hell, is he?
I'm afraid he is. Chances are he's likely burning in the flames of hell right now. But I'm worried about you. I'd like to see you saved. Why don't you sit here for the rest of the service?
Yes, sir.
That's fine. So good to have you.
What you have just witnessed is an example of what I've been talking about, how suddenly life can become death. I don't like bringing this matter up in the hour of this young man's bereavement, but for his sake and for the sake of every lost soul listening to me today, I feel that I must. Less than an hour ago, this young man's friend said to me, "Preacher, I don't worry about going to hell, for if I do go to hell, all my friends will be there to greet me." What a mistaken concept that is. There's no such thing as friendship in hell. There will be no TV programs to watch or movies to go see. There will be no cookouts to enjoy or sunsets to watch together. No vacation trips with the family. All will be one long night of sorrow, remorse, and regret forever and forever. Oh, how such memories will haunt you in hell. You will not be able to get away from them. Go back in your mind. Think. Perhaps you made fun of someone passing out tracts on a busy street corner. You thought it all a big joke.
Good evening. Glad to see you. Have a gospel tract. Glad to see you. Good evening. Glad to see you, friends. I would like you to have a tract on how to be born again on the three crosses of Calvary. And I thank you for coming this way. Good evening. Glad to see you. Have a gospel tract.
Lay it on us, preacher.
Well, you see, this tract says how to be born again. And I'd like to tell you about it. And that's why I'm standing here today, is to show you how to be saved. You know, there are two places to go to. One is heaven and the other is hell. If you go to hell, you'll burn forever because the Bible says where the worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. Where would you go if you were to die today?
What kind of bull are you preaching, man?
Why don't you save that stuff for the kindergarten kids? They might go for that hell stuff, but not us dudes. We believe that hell is right here on earth.
Many of you know that you have been witnessed to time and time again, but you still are not saved. Why not? Some of you are still lost because you're afraid of what your friends would say if you should accept Christ. Yet remember what Jesus said in Mark 8:38. Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Would you stay lost just to please your friends? If so, you will regret it down there. Notice what happens to friendships in hell. From the book of Daniel, we have the story of King Belshazzar on earth. Then he lived it up with his friends. What a day of confusion it must have been for him, with all of his kingly power stripped from him, and he being escorted to hell by demons. Let's see him on his arrival in hell.
Get your filthy hands off me. I'll have you flogged and beheaded for this. Guards! Guards!
Your guards cannot help you now, Majesty.
Where are we?
Look around you, Majesty. You're in hell.
It is I, the King of Babylon.
Go your way, Belshazzar. It's because of you that I'm in this place.
I thought he'd be glad to see me.
Well, I'm not. You led me in paths of unrighteousness through this, and now you've got me here in this awful pain. For this, I hate you. I hate you.
He used to love me. There wasn't anything he would not do for me.
You'll find that no one loves another here. The great passion in hell is to hate one another, King.
That's what every lost soul finds out in hell. There is no love, only hate. Sister hates sister and brother hates brother. The parade of faces that Belshazzar sees are countless. Hundreds of those whom he reveled with were there. But no matter how great they were on earth, whether Pharaoh or king or captain, they were all reduced to just another suffering soul doomed to everlasting torment. And the same applies to friends and relatives of your own. If they're not saved, there is no alternative. There is only one answer, hell. Real and hot and terrible. I thank God for preachers who still preach it this way. And now, listen to these profound words by Dr. Jack Hiles.
Is there a hell? If there's no hell, I'd close my Bible. If there's no hell, I would not preach another sermon as long as I live. If there's no hell, I would take life easy. I would not go day and night. But I'm convinced from the crown of my head to the sole of my feet that there is a hell. Our Lord Jesus spoke about it when he said in Matthew 25:41, then shall he say to those on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Again, he spoke about the place in Mark 9, where the worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. Hell is a place of eternal fire. Hell is a place of eternal falling. Hell is a place of eternal conscience. Hell is a place of eternal lust. And hell is a place of only one answered prayer. When one day people shall cry from hell and say, let us out, let us out. They'll come out to stand before the great white throne judgment of God and be cast once again into the place prepared for those who are unprepared.
Are you prepared? This isn't your first invitation to get saved. No doubt right now you recall other church services where you turned down God's invitation to be saved.
I plead with you today to come to give your heart and life to Jesus Christ. Like one of the thieves who simply received Christ in his heart and life. And he gazed upon the eyes of Jesus Christ and saw his compassionate eyes and said, Lord, remember me when thou comest in thy kingdom. And our Lord said, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Today you can be saved. Today you can come to the Lord Jesus Christ and have salvation. I urge you now
to come and to give your heart and life to Jesus Christ.
Tim, don't you think he's a good preacher?
Tim, Miss Fowle is talking to you.
I wish you wouldn't have made me come here. I feel so uncomfortable. That preacher man's trying to get to me.
Many of you are like one of the bad doers. You have rejected Jesus Christ as your Savior and your Lord.
Will you all stand, please, as the choir sings, Just As I Am?
I urge you right now to make your decision for Jesus Christ. Will you come right now?
I tell you, that preacher's working on me. Our church never tries to scare you into religion. Besides, I like the way our preacher teaches. He says everybody's a child of God.
But, Tim, your preacher's dead wrong. The only way anybody can be saved is through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Man, all this is just too much.
Tim, I'm so sorry for you.
Oh, how I wish I could help you to see how awful it would be to turn Jesus down and go to hell.
To me, one of the most awful things about hell will be the tormenting worms. In Isaiah chapter 14, verse 11, we read about people being in hell in a place where the worms are spread under them and the worms cover them. In Mark chapter 9, Jesus said, hell is a place where the worm dieth not. But you say, preacher, these are not literal worms, are they? God would not punish men like this, would he? The Bible says that he will. But you say, preacher, I've always thought that Jesus meant conscience when he said the worm dieth not. This cannot be the case. The word conscience is used 33 times in the New Testament. In every instance, it is the Greek word synodisis. The word used in Mark 9 is not synodisis. Instead, it is scolex. And the word scolex means maggot. Therefore, the worms in hell are literal worms. Can you imagine what it would be like to have worms gnawing on your face, gnawing on your mouth, your ears, your arms, your whole body? Can you imagine the torture caused by such worms? Think of the horrible odors, the continual itchiness. Imagine what pain they will give. No wonder the Bible says that there will be weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. In Acts 12, we have the only other time in the New Testament where the word scolex is used. It is in reference to one of the King Herods who was making a speech at Caesarea when he was eaten up of worms. This was the Herod who killed James and sought to kill Peter. He had just accepted a claim as God, but his subjects would soon learn that he was not God. Nor would he be a mortal man much longer, as you will see in this dramatized scene. For God will not share his glory with any man. Would soon be just a dim memory as the worms devoured his organs. They feasted on his black heart, relishing his gluttonous intestines. They devoured his eyeballs, his face, and all of him until nothing was left but the odorous, rotten form that had once been the evil Herod. What a horrible sight to behold. What an awful stench there must have been. Does this give you a nauseating feeling? Then think what it would be like not to behold it, but to be in it forever, where neither you or the worms shall ever die. In Luke 16, 19 to 31, Jesus tells us about two men. The name of the one was Lazarus. The name of the other is not given. He is simply called the rich man. There are those who teach that this is a parable, but it is not a parable. It is a story of two real men who lived on earth, and when they died, they went to two real places to live forever. Because we intend paraphrasing the rich man and Lazarus the beggar, we would first like to introduce the rich man, who shall be known as Dives in this motion picture. Dives loved to take trips with his friends and his five brothers. mainly because he wanted to impress them with his importance. The rich man had literally thousands of acres of land where his slaves worked their fingers to the bone. But to Dives, this unhumanitarian trait meant nothing. What mattered most, he was lord of all he surveyed. On occasions, his travels would take him to the almost dreamlike world of Petra, the red rose city hewed out of solid rock. This is Mount Seir and the Selah of the Old Testament. But Dives' trips were not one of sightseeing. He was out to make money and cheat anyone that he could. Philip and Nathaniel, two disciples of Jesus, were holding a service one day near the home of the rich man.
What's that terrible noise I hear, Nathan?
That's a group of those disciples, those followers of Jesus. They're over there singing and testifying.
Testifying and singing? Let's go see what those fanatics are doing. Come on, woman.
Of Nazareth? Who is he?
He's the leader of a false religion that's deceiving people all over this land. A fake, a deceiver, a false prophet. You don't need to follow him.
Thank you, ladies. Now I'd like for you to give your attention to my good friend, Nathaniel.
Thank you, Philip. Thank you. You know, as a disciple of Jesus of Nazareth, I must tell you of our mission, to preach and tell Jew and Gentile alike that he is the good shepherd who has come to save the people from their sins. Oh, I could not help but overhear your comments. But I, like yourselves, when I first heard of Jesus, I was not interested. But then my friend Philip here began to talk with such zeal and such enthusiasm about the Lord that I began to listen. And then I met him. And I was thoroughly convinced he is God's only begotten Son. I accepted him as my Savior. And if you will accept him, he will be your good shepherd and save you from your sins.
Nathaniel's right, good friends.
Thanks, but no thanks. We have much better things to do than to let some carpenter's son tell me what to do with my time. Good day, preacher.
Dives had no time for anything or anyone that did not increase his net worth or prestige, but he had plenty of time for personal pleasures. Let's observe Dives and his brothers on one of their fun days. They're getting ready to watch the gladiators perform one of their bloody and murderous deeds.
What is the event today, Dives?
A group of runaway slaves are being put to death by the gladiators. This one ought to be great fun.
Be gone, boys. Be gone. Be gone. Let's go, my dear.
Master Dives, could I have some scraps to eat? I'm very hungry.
If you are hungry, why don't you go to work and earn your own food?
I would be glad to, if I could, but I'm so weak. I can do nothing but sit here and wait for a few crumbs.
All you beggars are alike. Jonas, go! Go to the kitchen and get a piece of stale bread, mind you, stale bread, and give to this miserable, poor, wretched beggar. I'm going to speak to my good friend King Herod about passing a law prohibiting all you miserable beggars from off the street.
Nathan, did you make preparations for some good seats?
They gave us great seats, right where the gladiator's axle sink into the fallen slave's heart.
Excellent, excellent. Let us now return home. I just hope that miserable Lazarus isn't still hanging around the gate.
Of you people, get off the streets before I get the centurions after you. Well, beggar, I see you're still here. Don't you have a home?
No, master. Not now. But one day, I shall live in a glorious mansion with my Lord.
If you're referring to my good and dear friend King Herod, why, he wouldn't have you within a mile of him.
I'm referring to as Jesus. Jesus of Nazareth.
Do you think he can help you?
He can and he has. I gave my soul to him and he saved me.
You don't look saved to me. You look sick and hungry and helpless.
All you see is my body. But when I accepted Jesus as my Savior, he took my sins away, brought peace to my soul, and made me acceptable to God.
Why doesn't he do something for that worn-out body of yours?
What does it matter how my body is treated? When I die, I shall go to a place of everlasting peace and joy. And I shall dwell in his glorious presence forever. Wouldn't you like him to be your savior and shepherd?
But like many today, Dives had no time for a savior or shepherd. His main concern was the preparation of a big banquet where all the important dignitaries of the whole land were invited. And the dignitaries responded by arriving. There was the infamous Pontius Pilate, the king of Syria and one of his wives, Licinius, a rich merchant from Tyre, King Herod and Queen Herodias, Abato, a Roman senator. Of course, Dives was in his glory with his entourage of women, much to the dismay of Mrs. Dives. Caiaphas, the high priest, paid his respects to the rich man.
I'll see you later, girls.
I want to thank you for that generous donation you sent to the temple.
Glad to.
The conversation between Dives and Caiaphas centered mainly around Jesus, a subject that was extremely distasteful to both the Jewish priest and to the rich man.
Why, he claims to be the Son of the Most High God. In fact, there's already much talk about him being crucified.
Well, I'll tell you this, Caiaphas. When we rid this land of people like this Jesus of Nazareth, this will be a much better country in which to live.
Thank you again for the fine offering.
Come on back in, girls.
What is it, boy?
Lazarus, the beggar, just died.
Thank my gods, my guests had already arrived.
Should we get some of the servants to carry out the carcass?
Yes, by all means.
As Lazarus lay in death, almost hidden by the darkness, what Dives did not know was that at the instant of his death, Lazarus was approached by heavenly visitors who were ready to carry him to the glories above.
Arise, my son. You are free now.
Thank you.
Oh, what a glorious day that must have been for Lazarus. And what a day it will be for you, if you're ready.
Welcome home, Lazarus. We've been waiting for you. You'll never again be hungry or thirsty or sick or lonely. But throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity, you will enjoy the blessings of the Lord.
When there is delighted with all of God's provisions for them, as Psalm 16:11 says, their pleasures at his right hand forevermore. Many will be the glorious events held by the river of water of life. All may drink freely thereof. What singing and shouting there will be forever. But let us go back to the celebration of the rich man, Dives. By now, the party was in full swing.
Quiet, everybody. I'm going to propose a toast to our great king, King Herod.
I feel sick. There's a pain, Chase. My arms hurt. I drink too much.
I'll get a physician.
But it was too late for a physician to do him any good. He was dead. He had attended his last banquet, and all that earth would ever see of him again would be when he would be laid out on his funeral bier.
Friends, our country has suffered a great loss of a great citizen in the passing of our friend Dives. Mr. Dives was a personal friend of mine. And while he was not faithful to attend many of the services, yet he was faithful to the temple and supported it with many generous gifts. I am sure that God understands that he was a busy man, and I have no doubt as to where he is now. He is in heaven, waiting for all the rest of us to meet him there.
But how wrong Caiaphas was. The Bible says that in hell he, Dives, lifted up his eyes, being in torment, and seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivedst thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he's comforted, and thou art tormented. And beside all this, between us and you there's a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence.
I pray thee, thou wouldst send Lazarus back to earth. To my wife and my brother, lest they also come. This place of torment,
They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them.
And they, Father Abraham? But if one of them from the dead, they would repent.
If they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead.
Why was the rich man so anxious for his brothers to be warned about hell? Was it because of his great love to them? I think not. He still had himself in mind. He knew that if his brothers came to hell, they would accuse him of leading them there, and this would add to his torture. But come to hell, they did.
I won't remember all the women in the line.
You miserable rat! Yes,
in ordinary stories, this would be the end. We could all get up, go home, and forget about it. But such is not the case in eternal stories like this. The events of this story shall go on forever and forever. The flames will leap up forever. The torture will be there forever. The memory will be there forever. The thirst will remain forever. Let's take a look at Dives 1,000 years after he's been in hell.
If I had only listened. But no, not me. I had to pay the big man. All these voices come back now to haunt me, even the beggar Lazarus.
What does it matter how my body is treated? When I die, I shall go to a place of everlasting ease and joy.
I'm tormented. I can't stand this.
But the story does not end here. At this very hour in the 20th century, while you and I are still enjoying our mortal lives, the rich man has already experienced almost 2,000 years of torture. This very minute he's suffering. The flames have not let up one bit. His tongue is still parched and dry. He is still accusing and being accused. Yet there's an awful dread that hangs over him and all other inhabitants of hell. It's the dread of that eventual day when he and they must stand before the great white throne for judgment. What shame and disgrace when their record is presented there. He knows that after his record has been read, he will hear the words, "Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels."
Then I shall be cast into the eternal lake of fire.
Although we've seen some horrible scenes of hell depicted in pictorial form so far, neither words or pictures can describe all of its terrors. As Hebrews 10:31 says, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Let me give you some other aspects of hell not dealt with so far. Hell is forever. 10,000 years from now, every sinner will still be in hell. 100,000 years from now, every sinner will still be in hell. 1,000,000 years from now, every sinner will still be in hell. 100,000,000 years from now, every sinner will still be in hell. 1,000,000,000 years from now, the inhabitants of hell will still be sinning, cursing, crying, swearing, in pain that no mortal man has to experience now. Take a look at this chart. My aim is to try to help you think of the length of time in hell. 1 with 9 zeros added to it represents 1,000,000 years. Add 3 more zeros and it represents 1,000,000,000 years. Add 3 more zeros and it represents 1,000,000,000,000 years. But as you can see here, you have 1 with all of these zeros representing 300 zeros years. After this much time has elapsed in hell, what time is it? Well, let me say this. After this much time has been consumed, there will still not be one speck of hope for a sinner to ever escape hell. He must remain there forever. One of America's leading preachers of today is Dr. Bob Gray. His views on this subject are very direct.
In spite of what the critics and the pseudo-intellectuals have to say about the subject of hell, I believe that the description of our Lord Jesus Christ in Luke chapter 16 is accurate. Here, our Savior depicts hell as a place where people go when they die who were not saved. And in that place, conscious torment is very clearly and plainly depicted. For example, many people are surprised to learn that the Bible in both the Old Testament and the New teaches that the soul follows in its ability to perceive sensation the same basic function as the body. For example, Jesus tells us in verse 23 that the rich man lifted up his eyes being in torments.
Young man, whose favor are you trying to court? Is that buddy of yours worth the torments of an eternal hell? I hate to put it this way, young man, But if you were in hell right now, you'd probably see him in an agonizing fire. You'd see torture like you've never seen before. Hell is called a bottomless pit. This means that sinners will be falling, falling, falling forever. There'll never be a solid footing under you. In Revelation chapter 9, we read about some horrible creatures that live in hell who will be a part of the eternal torments there. They come up on earth for a 5-month period of time to torture mortals, yet they will no doubt return to hell to torment the damned forever. They're called locusts, but are not like any locust you've ever seen before. Their body is like a horse. Their breastplate is a breastplate of iron. They have teeth like a lion, hair like a woman, and they wear crowns of gold. Their tails are like that of a scorpion. The ceaseless tortures of the damned will echo in your ears forever. Think of the plight of Esau.
This, because I sold my soul for a mess of pottage.
Every sinner who has ever gone to hell.
This thing goes on forever. I can listen to that.
Company in hell will be pretty gruesome. The unregenerated murderers of all ages will be there. Years ago, when this earth was brand new, we read of the first murder in Genesis chapter 4. And Cain talked with Abel, his brother. And it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and slew him. Chances are that Cain choked his brother to death. But whatever was his murder weapon, you can rest assured his memory will never let him forget it. 2 Kings chapter 8, we read of another horrible murder. Hazael killed his king Ben-Hadad, who lay sick in bed. Hazael took a thick cloth, dipped it in water, and held it over Ben-Hadad's face until he was dead. Time doesn't permit me to talk about Ahab and Jezebel. Athaliah, the wicked queen, the Pharaoh of the Exodus, or any of the other murderers of the Old and New Testament. There are thousands that we could talk about. But let's bring up one more example. The killers of John the Baptist. Herod and Herodias and Salome were the principal characters. Yet the fellow who chopped off the head of John the Baptist was also involved. They'll all be there. Friend, ask yourself if it's worth it to go to hell. If you were in hell this very moment, you'd change your mind. In all probability, you'd see some of these same murderers mentioned in the Bible.
Must have just arrived. I don't remember seeing you before. How long have you been dead?
I don't know.
His name is Phaziel. He chopped off the head of John the Baptist and gave it to Salome. And he's not allowed to forget. He thinks everyone's John the Baptist. You're not John the Baptist, are you?
No, I'm not.
Poor Cain, I wish he'd stop looking at his hands. That's the way he killed his brother Abel. Choked him to death. Oh, and that's Haziel. He used to be king of Syria, a That is, he became king after he murdered Ben-Hadad. But down here, he's just another doomed soul.
Why is that man looking at me?
I told you before. He thinks you look like John the Baptist.
He's still alive! He's still alive! But this time, I'll kill him!
I don't know what happened.
Young man, I can see that what I've told you about hell has affected you. I thank God for that. I don't know what your thoughts have been, but no matter how horribly you visualized hell, it's much worse than that. The next step is up to you. God wants you saved, but you must respond to him. Why don't you get up from where you are right now and come to the altar? You'll never regret it. This is the most important decision you'll ever make. Chapter 6 and verse 37. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. Are you ready to let Jesus Christ save you right now?
Yes, sir.
Then will you ask him to?
Lord, I know I've sinned. Forgive me. Forgive me, Lord. I know you've talked to my heart. I haven't listened to you, Lord. Save me, Lord. I want to come home. I don't want to go to hell like Ken did. Save me, Lord. Please.
All right, Tim. Has he saved you?
Yes, sir.
If you're dying right now, where would you go?
Straight to heaven.
How do you know that you would?
I know Jesus. He's coming to my heart.
Let's thank him for saving your soul. Father, thank you for saving Tim tonight. We thank you that you brought him to this service. We thank you that you've done the job that you always do when sinners come to you. Say them. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Wouldn't you also like to come to Jesus and be saved today? Perhaps you're saying, Preacher, I couldn't come after a message like that. People would say I'd been scared into getting saved. What would that matter? You're looking at a man who in 1940 got scared that I'd go to hell. And I came to Jesus and he saved me. He would do the same for you if you would let him. Won't you get up from where you are and come to the altar right now? He wants to save you.